He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave Explains.
Okay guys, for today's problem, we're gonna look at this reaction. We have two stereoisomers. These two molecules both have a bromo group and a tert-butyl group, but on this compound those are cis, and on this compound those are trans. Now, what we're looking at is that those both will undergo E2 elimination with tert-butoxide to form these two products. However, from the cis compound, the reaction is very fast, and from the trans isomer, the reaction is very slow. And the question is simply, why? So if this is confusing, we're going to want to take a look at E2 elimination reactions, as well as, hint, hint, cyclohexane chair conformations. To answer this question, there are two key points that we have to recall. The first is that in order for an elimination to occur, the leaving group and the proton, the beta proton being extracted in the elimination, they must be anti-paraplanar. And if we are doing this on a cyclic system, if we're doing this on a cyclohexane ring, they must be both in the axial position in order to be anti to one another. So what that means is that over here on this chair, we're saying that for the cis isomer, this chair is exclusively the one from which elimination can proceed. This one is not going to work because the leaving group is equatorial. So when the leaving group is equatorial, it's actually anti to the rest of the ring, and so it's not going to be able to proceed from that conformation. So this chair is going to work for cis, and then likewise for the trans. This one is not going to work because there it's equatorial. And then over here, we've got these beta protons. So these two chairs, this chair for the cis and this chair for the trans, are the conformations from which E2 can proceed. So that's part one. Number two is to look at the stability here. So if we look at the stability, we understand that the tert-butyl group is a very bulky group. It provides a lot of steric hindrance. And so there's a pretty huge premium on that tert-butyl group being in the equatorial position. So it more or less tethers the molecule in a particular conformation because of the extreme thermodynamic favorability of that group being equatorial over axial. So E2 can occur from both molecules. From the cis, we could say grab that proton, and then we do the elimination, and that would lead to one of those. And we could also do that over here. Let's take this all the way down. Let's say we get that proton, that's a beta proton, and we do this elimination, and that could lead to one of those products. Now, but the thing is, in solution, the distribution of conformations reflects the thermodynamic favorability. And so almost all of the time, this cis isomer is going to look like that conformation because of the thermodynamic favorability of putting the tert-butyl in the equatorial group. So that means that if a tert-butoxide collides with this molecule, it almost always is going to look like this. And so it's probably going to be able to extract a proton and have the elimination go. However, for the trans isomer, the molecules are almost always going to look like this, right? Because this is the one where the tert-butyl group is in the equatorial position. And so that means tert-butoxide might collide with a molecule of substrate a million times before it finally finds one that is in the correct conformation for elimination to occur, because it is going to have to overcome that overwhelming energetic unfavorability to do the chair flip and get into this position, because the tert-butyl group does not want to be in the axial position. There's too many diaxial interactions. So both of these can do E2. They will do so from specifically these chair conformations, but because the trans isomer, the chair from which E2 can occur, is so much more unfavorable energetically, the end result on the macroscopic scale is that this reaction is much, much, much slower than that one. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.